गुरुरेव गतिः गुरुमेव भजे गुरुणैव सहास्मि नमो गुरवे न गुरोः परमं शिशुरस्मि गुरोर्मतिरस्ति गुरौ मम पाहि गुरो राम राम. So in the previous class, three classes we have been doing Raghuvamsham, and today let us continue from where we left. So till now we have completed Dashama Sarga, the 10th Sarga we have completed, wherein Dasharatha has begetted 4 sons, Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata and Shatrughna, and that is where the 10th Sarga ended. So now we will start with the 11th Sarga, Ekadasha Sarga. Kaushikena kila kshitishwaro Rama Madhvari Vighata Shantaye काकपक्षधरमेत्य याचितः तेजसाहिन वयः समीक्षते. सो नौ एज यू कैन सी कालिदास, आई हैव टोल्ड यू, कालिदास हैज टेकन रामायण विच वाल्मीकि हैज रिटन, एंड ही हैज रिटन इट इन एज कंसाइज्ड वे एज पॉसिबल विदाउट लीविंग आउट एनी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट्स बट गोइंग थ्रू स्विफ्टली. सो हियर डायरेक्टली फ्रॉम रामास बर्थ वी आर गोइंग डायरेक्टली टू कौशिका. सो कौशिका इज नथिंग बट विश्वामित्र. सो हियर द विश्वामित्र इंसिडेंट हैज स्टार्टेड. सो कौशिकेन सकिल क्षितीश्वरो, सो कौशिका दट इज विश्वामित्र, ही केम टू दशरथ क्षितीश्वर द राजा दशरथ वै राम मध्वरी विघात शांतये इन ऑर्डर टू टेक राम फॉर प्रोटेक्टिंग हिम फ्रॉम दि विघात शांतये, सो फॉर फ्रॉम द डिस्ट्रॉयर्स ऑफ दि अध्वरी द यज्ञ. सो देर वर अ लॉट ऑफ डीमंस हु वर ट्रबलिंग, सो टू प्रोटेक्ट दि यज्ञ फ्रॉम दीज डिस्ट्रॉयर्स ही हैड कम टू दशरथ टू टेक राम, एंड काक पक्षधरम इत्य याचितः इन ऑर्डर टू ask for Rama because tejasam hi nahi na vayah samikshyate. So here beautifully Kalidasa mentions that tejasam, for the people who are courageous, vayah na samikshyate, age is never considered. Even when we read Kumara Sambhava, there we had come across a statement when Parvati was doing immense, you know, penance, and people from all around the world had come to see, there Kalidasa had told that na dharma vriddheshu vayah samikshyate, for people who are very very involved in dharma, age is not a factor. Here, Kalidasa again beautifully mentions that for people who are courageous, age is not a factor. Now again, swiftly Kalidasa goes further with the incident. So here Dasharatha immediately agreed to send Rama and Lakshmana with Vishwamitra, and Yavadadishati Parthivastayoho Nirkamaya Puramarga Sankriyam Tavadashu Vidadhe Marutsakaihi Sasapushpa Jala Vashibhir Ghanaihi. So now after having decided to send Rama as well as Lakshmana along with Vishwamitra, now in order to send them, the roads have to be cleaned. So Dasharatha sent an order telling that please clean all the roads of this city so that they can leave easily. And immediately once he gave this order, who, you know, fulfilled this order is Marutsakaihi. So the clouds, they fulfilled this order by showering rain and cleaning the roads, and further wind, it, you know, carried flowers from the trees and spread it on the ground. So this intends to show that Dasharatha was such a capable king that his order was not just fulfilled by the citizens and his people, but even gods like clouds and even Vayudeva, even they were supportive and they carried out his orders. So in this way, clouds showered rain and cleaned the roads, and wind brought flowers from the trees and spread it on the ground. लक्ष्मणानुचरमेव राघवं नैतुमिच्छत् ऋषिः इत्यसौ नृपः आशिषं प्रययुजे न वाहिनीं साहि रक्षणविधौ तयोः क्षम. नौ व्हाट डिड विश्वामित्र आस्क दैट आई ओनली वांट रामा, दैट इज हिज ओनली नो रिक्वेस्ट, आई डोंट वांट यू, आई डोंट वांट योर आर्मी, आई वांट ओनली रामा. सो राघवं केवलं ऐच्छत् दैट ऋषि सेज विश्वामित्र ओनली विश टू टेक रामा विथ हिम, बट सिंस इन द प्रीवियस सर्ग वी हैव सीन Dvandva, there were two pairs, one was Rama Lakshmana and one was Bharata Shatrughna, they were inseparable. Since Rama and Lakshmana were inseparable, when he asked for Rama, he was always followed by Lakshmana. So now when he asked for Rama, but he has also got Lakshmana along with him, and nahi vahini, but he did not want vahini, vahini's army. So even though Dasharatha pleaded, okay, you take Rama and Lakshmana, but along with them please take this army, Vishwamitra told nahi vahini, I don't want your army. And in that case, what did Dasharatha send along with Rama and Lakshmana? Ashisham. He sent only his blessings. And Kalidasa beautifully tells that Sahi Rakshana Vidhau Tayoho Kshama. Only that blessing was capable of protecting them. It was not the army that was capable of protecting Rama and Lakshmana. It was the blessing given by Dasharatha to his sons that were capable of protecting them. Finally, as they go, of course, it's a very long journey, but still Kalidasa mentions that neither Lakshmana nor Rama, neither of them were fatigued, neither of them were tired of constantly walking. And further, later on, Vishwamitra even gives them the power of Bala and Atibala. And because of the power of Bala and Atibala, they were neither affected by fatigue, hunger, or thirst. So they could carry
Anna,
on.
Anna, where were they going?
They were going towards Vishwamitra's ashrama where the Yajna had to be protected. So on the way, they're given the power of Bala and Atibala by Vishwamitra, which removes. So, you know, whenever you're traveling for such a long time, you'll feel hungry, you'll feel thirsty. But because of the power of this Bala and Atibala, they were not affected by hunger or thirst. Also, they were never bored. So they have to travel for such a long time, but you know, they may finally feel bored. But Kalidasa tells that they never had a chance to get bored because Vishwamitra constantly told them very beautiful stories from Puranas and Itihasas. So whenever they went to a new place, Vishwamitra told, okay, this is the Sthala Purana. So this place is where Shiva came and did something like this. And this is the story behind this. So he constantly told them stories, which kept them amused. So they were never, you know, they were never bored when they were doing this. And again, being a Prakriti Kavi, the description of the travel is also explained in a beautiful way. Finally, after a long journey, they reach the place where Suketu's daughter Tataka is living. So Tataka is a demoness and Suketu is the father. So that place where Tataka is living is where they reach. And Kalidasa tells that till this point of time, Rama and Lakshmana were just carrying bows. So usually you don't tie the string on the bow every time, because if you constantly tie the bow with the string, that string becomes loose. So only you tie it when it is necessary. So till this point of time, Rama and Lakshmana have come without stringing their bows. But once they reach this place, and Vishwamitra tells, so this is the place where Tataka, the demoness, lives, that is when Rama and Lakshmana tie their bow. It indirectly tells that even though Rama and Lakshmana were so young, they knew, you know, they had presence of mind and they knew when they have to be ready for war and when they have to be at ease. So once they tied the string, in order to check how good their string is tied, they twanged or they pulled the string and lifted. Listening to the twang, Tataka appears there. And after, you know, a lot of, okay, Tataka tries to throw a, you know, tree, Tataka tries to throw a mountain, everything. But Rama does not want to kill, because Rama knows that it is not advisable to kill a woman. But when Vishwamitra tells that you're following my orders, don't worry about any papa or anything, so do your duty. That is when Rama, finally abiding the guru's orders, he releases an arrow and kills Tataka. Now, after being pleased by how Rama and Lakshmana easily killed Tataka, Vishwamitra further instructs them with several types of astras and shastras. Then they finally go to a place called, they finally go to Vamanashrama. So Vamana was the previous avatar, one of the previous avatars of Vishnu. So Rama in this current avatar does not remember anything about his previous avatar. But still, once he goes to that Vamana ashrama, he feels something pleasant. He feels something good about that place. But of course, he does not remember anything that has happened in his past. So after that, finally, they finally reach Vishwamitra's ashrama. The Homa starts and Rama and Lakshmana are placed in charge of protecting the Yaga. So again, once the Yaga starts, several asuras, several demons, they start to come and try to destroy the Yajna. But then Rama does not worry about any of the other asuras, because see, if there is a rule, if there is a leader among an army, and if you, defeat or destroy that leader, the army is immediately defeated. Because even in Panchatantra Katha Mukham, sorry, in Chitragriva Katha, we saw, Nagana Syagrato Gachet Siddhe Karya Samamphalam. So you should not be the leader, because if you are defeated, the entire team is defeated. So Rama made it a point not to, you know, shoot arrows at the other asuras, but his only intention was to shoot and defeat the leaders of these armies, that is Maricha and Subahu. So, you know, Kalidasa crisply, in a very short way, he tells that Rama kills Subahu and he throws Maricha away with Vayu Vyastra. Again, what you should understand is there is some change or some variation between Valmiki Ramayana and Kalidasa's Ramayana, because some of the astras that are mentioned, for example, here it is told that Vayu Vyastra, it may not be the same that Valmiki has told in his Valmiki Ramayana. So that change is there, but this is how Kalidasa has mentioned. So with Vayu Vyastra, he threw Maricha several yojanas away. Finally, in this way, they protected. So having lost the leaders, the asuras became scared and they ran away. And hence, the Yaga was completed without any disturbance, and that Rama and Lakshmana had protected the Yaga. Now, once this is done, Vishwamitra is very pleased that he is very pleased that Rama and Lakshmana were capable enough to protect the Yaga, and they are praised by Vishwamitra and the other sages. And at that exact point, Janaka sends one of his messengers to Vishwamitra. So the message is that Janaka is performing some Vedic ritual, some Vedic practice, and he's inviting all the sages and all the prominent people all around the world. And one such invitation has also come to Vishwamitra. So Vishwamitra asks Rama, so your job is done. So the job that had got you for was to help me protect this yaga. The job is done. Do you want to accompany me or do you want to go back to Ayodhya? So here you should understand that when a guru is asking you something, it means that there's something hidden. So if guru is asking you that if you want to come, then the shishya should understand that there's some intention that the guru is calling him for. That is why Rama agrees. Of course, even it is told that Rama has heard stories about the Shivadhanas that is present in Janaka's palace. So he is also eager to see that, Shivadhanas, as well as he's also interested in following his guru's orders. So he does it. Okay, I will accompany you. And hence, Vishwamitra takes Rama and Lakshmana to see that famous Shivadhanas. On the way, of course, again, there is a beautiful description of nature. But finally, just outside the city of Mithila, that is Janakapuri, they come to Ahalya's ashrama. And there, Svayam Vapu Sakila Kilbishat Chidam Rama Pada Rajasam Anugraha. That Ahalya, just by the touch of or by the dust raised by the foot of Rama, was cleansed. And again, we know the story. She, from her stone, she regained her form. But of course, there are, from various stories, be it Amar Chitrakatha, be it the films we see, be it the serials we see about Ramayana, this common understanding or the common picturization of this scene is, so there is a stone in the form of a woman. Once Rama's foot touches that stone, that stone becomes a woman. But when I was going through this Raghuvamsha, and I was, going through some, there was a commentaries written by other poets, a very beautiful point came into picture. So this common understanding is actually a misunderstanding is what they tell, because it is not actually that Ahalya had become physically a stone. So what would have happened is, once Ahalya is cursed by Gautama, the curse is nothing but she is banished from society. So she is not told to become a stone, but she is banished. That is, she is removed from society, telling that no one will contact you. You will not be, spoken to, or you will not be helped by any other person in the society. And understand this. Let us say you're walking on a path. You're walking on a road. On the sides, you have so many stones. Do you sit and, see every stone and think, okay, this is a very beautiful stone. This is a, very round stone. You don't see. Stones are lying everywhere. So they're neglected. Similarly, what is happening is, this meaning of Shila, that is being a stone, is like she's neglected from society. She's not becoming a physical stone. It is a metaphorically used statement that she has become a stone, indicating that she's neglected from society. That is, no one will speak to her. No one will help her. No one will assist her. So that is how she has become a stone. She's not physically a stone. She's just metaphorically a stone. And when Rama goes to this ashrama, first thing he does is he salutes. Because Rama does not worry about the Purva Vrittanta. He does not worry about the mistakes or the bad deeds or whatever done by the other person. If that person is respectable, yes, he'll surely respect that person. So once Rama goes into the ashrama and salutes this foot, so once he enters into the ashrama, the dust raised by Rama on entering the ashrama, that purified Ahalya, and hence she was removed from this banishment. So the banishment that Gautama had enforced, it went back, and she regained her prominent status in society, and she regained her, glamour. So that is how this Ahalya Shapa Vimochana is beautifully described. So this seems a more believable explanation for Ahalya Shapa Vimochana, rather than seeing a stone being touched by Rama and then becoming a woman. So this is one important point that I wanted to bring to your notice. So now, after having performed this Ahalya Shapa Vimochana, finally they enter into the Janakapuri, that is Videha. Again, as in any Kalidasa's great poems, Atithi Satkara is done, Pada Puja is done, and Kushalopari is asked. After that, beautifully Kalidasa tells it, Tasya Viksha Lalitam Vapuh Shishoho Parthiva Pratita Vamsha Janmanah Swayam Vichintya Cha Dhanur Durananam Pidito Duhitra Shulka Samsthaya. So now, after having performed all these, Atithi Satkara to Vishwamitra, now Janaka looks at that young Rama. Tasya Viksha, having seen that Lalitam Vapuh, that beautiful, body or the beautiful figure of Rama, and also, he has come to know that they are none other than the descendants of Raghu. That is, they are from Raghu Vamsha itself, born to Dasharatha. So, Prathita Vamsha Janmanaha, they are not just beautiful, they are also born in a very good clan. So, now he feels Swayam Vichintya. Now, he is feeling very sad. Vai Durananam Dhuitra Shulka Samsthaya. Now, the point comes that he is very sad that he has put such a big condition on the marriage of his daughter. Dhuitra is daughter, Shulka Samstha is condition. So, he's feeling sad that he has seen such a beautiful boy who can be a very fitting match to Sita. And also he's born in a very good class. So such a good alliance with such a great kingdom is very good. But the only thing that is obstructing him from making him his bride groom, that is to marry Sita, is Duhitya Shulka Samstha. That is the condition laid on the marriage of his daughter. So he's feeling very sad that I shouldn't have put this condition, or else I could have immediately asked Rama's hand for Sita. Finally, after, you know, again, here there is one more important point. So again, why I'm telling you these things is our common understanding about Ramayana, about Ahalya, Shapa Vimochana, or Sita Swayamvara is totally different from what actually Valmiki has described in his Valmiki Ramayana. So in our usual understanding, when we see Ramayana film or Ramayana serial, what is the situation of Sita Swayamvara? So there is a huge, arena. Several kings from all around the world are invited. They come and sit in their seats. So in the middle of the arena is this Shivadhanas, and on the throne, Janaka is sitting, and next to him is Sita. So he announces in public, to all the kings that whoever lifts this Shivadhanas and puts the string around it, he will marry my daughter Sita. But this is actually not the situation, even as mentioned in Valmiki Ramayana. So the actual thing, what is the condition that Janaka has laid is, so Shivadhanas, that is Shunabha, was given to Janaka. And it is there since since Sita was born, even before Sita was born, that is has been there in this palace of Janaka. At a young age, when Sita was playing, a ball goes and falls, it gets stuck under the Shivadhanas, and Sita easily lifts the Shivadhanas and picks the ball and puts it back. So seeing that capability of Sita, that time, Janaka decides that any person marrying Sita should also be capable of doing this act of lifting the Shivadhanas. So he puts that condition. And it is not like he, calls all the kings and does a Swayamvara. So any king can come at any point of time and he can try. So if he wants to come and try, he'll tell, okay, Janaka, I want to try lifting your bow. So that, big Shivadhanas is brought, and then he tries to lift it. If he's capable of lifting it, yes, he's married, or else he goes back. So it's not like a Swayamvara where everyone is called and this Swayamvara is done. Everyone can come at any point of time and try lifting the bow. So that is one misconception that we should let go of. Sita Swayamvara is not a collection of kings. Anyone can come at any time and try doing this act. So now Vishwamitra asks Janaka to get that bow. Now Janaka thinks, and he tells beautifully that Abravicha Bhagavan Matanga Jaihi Yat Brihadbhirapi Karma Dushkaram Tatranaham Anumantu Mutsahe Mogha Vritti Kalabasya Cheshtitam. Bhagavan, O Lord, so this task, Karma Dushkaram, is very difficult. Mahadbhi Matanga Jaihi, even for great, well-built people who are as strong as elephants, even for those people, this task is Dushkaram, is very difficult. Hence, Anumantum Na Utsahe, hence I don't want to ask Rama to do this job, because Kalabhasya Cheshtitam Mogha Vritti. He is a calf. So those kings who attempted this previously are like elephants. And this Rama is just a calf. He's a small baby elephant. Hence, if asking him to do this job is foolishness, hence I don't want to ask him to do this job. And he also tells that, when people have tried lifting this, bow, some people have, lost their arms. Their arms have broken. And, by trying to pull the string, their fingers have, cut off. So such a dangerous job this is. So I don't want Rama to do this job. But then, Vishwamitra tells, don't worry, just get the bow. Finally, Janaka, Vyadi Desha Gana Shotha Parshvagan, Karmukabhi Haranaya Maithilaha, Taijasasya Dhinusha Pravrtaye, Toya Daniva Sahasra Lochanaha. So finally, after having been Vyadi Desha, have been ordered by Vishwamitra to get the bow. So Karmuka is a Samanarthaka Pada for bow. So Karmukabhi Haranaya, so Maithilaha, that King Dasharatha, Janaka, he ordered Parshvagan, all his servants, to bring that Karmuka, that bow. And how were they bringing? And it's not like one or two people are bringing. Sahasra, there are thousands of people who are pushing that, cart on which the Shivadhanas is placed. And beautifully, Kalidasa tells a simile that Taijasasya Dhanusha Pravartaye. So Taijasasya Dhanusha is nothing but rainbow. Similar to how, in order to place the rainbow, thousands of clouds push and bring and place that rainbow on the orders of Indra. Sahasra Lochanaha. Sahasraksha is Indra. So when Indra orders the rainbow to be placed, how thousands of clouds, bring that rainbow and place it. Similarly, on the order of Janaka, thousands of servants have dragged that Shivadhanas and brought it. Now, after having done this, what happens? Tat prasupta bhujagindra bhishanam viksha dasharathi radha de dhanuhu vidruta krama mriganusarinam yena banam atsrijat vrishadvajah. So, having seen, so how is that bow? Supta bhujagendra bhishanam. It is as though like a sleeping snake, but which is a very big snake. Bhishanam bhujagendraha. Like a very big snake that is sleeping, that bow is resting on that cart. And viksha dasharathi. So Rama saw that. What did he do? Vidruta katuhu mriganusarinam. So similar. So there is a side story. I'll tell you the side story first and then I'll come to the shloka. So the side story is when Daksha Prajapati's yajna was being destroyed by Shiva, in the form of Veerabhadra. So what happens is, Veerabhadra is sitting on Nandi and he is, destroying everything in the yaga, that is, the Homa, the Punyahuti, everything he is destroying. At that point, every yajna has an Agni Purusha. That is, Yajna Purusha is the person who is residing in that yajna. And that person, being scared that Veerabhadra will even destroy him, he'll take the form of a deer. He'll take the form of a deer and he'll start running away. But Veerabhadra having seen this deer, he would have shot an arrow, which would have cut the head off. And that head would have gone and become a nakshatra called Mrigashira. Mrigashira. Mriga is deer, Shira is head. So Mrigashira is nothing but the Agni Purusha in the form of a deer, whose head was cut off by Veerabhadra. So this is a side story. Now, similar to how Vrishabdhvaja is nothing but Shiva. Similar to how Shiva at the Daksha Yajna had very easily shot an arrow at that Agni Purusha in the form of a deer. Similarly, even Rama had easily lifted that bow. He has put that string and now he is pulling at the string. So similar to how Shiva, it is his dhanas, it is his bow. So he is very, he is very familiar with the bow. But being such a heavy bow, Rama should have found it difficult. But Rama, similar to how easily Shiva had lifted this bow during Daksha Yajna's destruction, Rama also lifted this bow with ease. Finally, the people who had come there were amazed that such a small boy could, lift such a huge elephant, huge bow, which is resembling an elephant or even a mountain, and had effortlessly, strung this bow. And finally, Bhajyamana mati matra karshanat tena vajja parusha swanam dhanuhu bhargavaya dhridamanyave punaha kshatra mudyam iva nyavedayat. So, after having put this pratyancha, that is the string, Rama, any archer, first thing he does after tying the string is he tests how taunt or how, strong the wire is or the string is. So, even he tried to pull it. But atimatra kashana, just by pulling a little more than needed, tena vajja parusha swanam dhanuhu, that bow broke into two, giving a thunderous sound. Dhanuhu vajra parasham. So it gave a sound similar to vajra, that is lightning. And how was this lightning sound? Bhargavaya. So it sent a message to Bhargava. So now Bhargava has gone around the world 21 times killing Kshatriyas. And now he is resting. That is, work is done. But this sound has gone and reached Bhargava, that Parashurama, such that as though Kshatriyas have again come back to power and they are doing atrocities, they are causing trouble to the Brahmanas. In a similar way, this sound has gone and given a message to Bhargava. So now, as Janaka has finally decided, so after this is done, so Janaka has decided that Ayonija, since she is not born from any parent, she is born from earth, she is called Ayonija. So she is married to Rama and he's decided. So it is decided that Rama will marry Sita, but again, the message has to be sent to Rama's father also. So Dasharatha is also, is the message is sent to Dasharatha with a Purohita. Then that Purohita goes and meets the king and he's about to give the message. But at this exact time, Dasharatha is also thinking. So Dasharatha is also deep in thought thinking that, okay, my Rama has come to marriageable age. So she would find a good daughter-in-law to get him married. At that exact time, this good news of Rama's marriage with Sita comes and Kalidasa beautifully tells that Sadhya eva sukritam hipachyati kalpa vriksha phaladharmi kaankshitam. The thoughts that good people, that noble men bear, noble men think will bear fruits immediately. So if a good person thinks of something, then that will happen immediately, similar to how kalparuksha. So kalparuksha, the beauty is, once it is born, it will immediately give fruits. Whereas other plants, they'll have to grow, they have to bear trees, flowers, then they have to bear fruits. But kalparuksha is not like that. Once it is born, it will immediately bear fruits. Similarly, the thoughts of great people will also bear immediate fruits. So once this is done, Dasharatha arrives at Mithila and they both are, Dasharatha and Janaka, they both are coming and meeting together. And it is as though Indra and Varuna are meeting together. So this beautiful description Kalidasa gives. Parthivim udvahat raghudvaha lakshmanah tadanujam atham urmilam yau tayovarajau varaujasau tau kushadvajasute samudhyame. So Parthivi is Sita, one who is born from Prithivi. So Parthivi, Sita was married to raghudvaha, that is Rama, the foremost among Raghu. Lakshmanah tadanujam, Lakshmana married the sister of Sita, that is Urmila. Tau Yavaraja. So those two other sons of Dasharatha, that is Bharata and Shatrughna, they married Kushadvaja Sute. They married the daughters of Kushadvaja. So Kushadvaja is the maternal uncle of Sita. He's the brother of Janaka. So he married those Bharata Shatrughna married the daughters of Kushadvaja. Now, how are these newlywed couples beautifully Kalidasa tells that Ta Naradhipasuta Nripatmachaihi Techa Tabhihi Agaman Kritarthatam Sobhavat Varavadhu Samagamaha Pratyaya Prakriti Yoga Sannipaha. So those daughters of Janaka and Kushadvaja have gone and married the sons of Dasharatha. And Varavadhu Samagamaha, that union of these princesses and princes is such that Pratyaya Prakriti Yoga Sannipaha. Similar to how a word gains meaning when Pratyaya. So Pratyaya is the root word and Pratyaya is the prefix and Prakriti is the root word. So when the prefix and the root word come together, how the meaning becomes complete by the union of these princesses and prince, the word marriage got the apt name or it attained completion. So now all the marriage rituals are all done and they are coming back to the kingdom of Dasharatha. And at this point of time, they observe several inlaments. So there are several apshakunas that they observe. And Dasharatha asks Vasishta that why are all these apshakunas being seen? And then Vasishta tells that Swantam, Suantam, everything will end well. He tells that, and before even he completes his sentence, Tejasa Sapati Rashi Ruthitaha, Pradurasa Kila Vahini Mukhe, Yaf Pramrija Nayanani Sainikaihi, Lakshaniya Purusha Kritishchirat. And immediately once this is done, a huge column of light instantly appears in front of the army. So of course, there's a large army that has come along with Dasharatha. And now as they are going back in front of that army, a huge column of light emanates and it is so bright that the Sainikas are unable to open their eyes. And after a lot of time, Chirat, after a long time, after having rubbed their eyes for a long time, in the middle of that column of light, they could see a Purushakriti, a figure of a human body. Who is this person? Pitriyamamsham upavita lakshanam matrikam cha dhanurjitam dadath yah sasoma iva gharmadidhitihi sadvijihva iva chandanadrumaha. So this person is very peculiar. Why? Pitriyam amsham. So as a sign of his paternal side, so from his father's side, what is he wearing? He's wearing a upavita. And matrikam, from the maternal side, he's holding a bow. So from a upavita, you think that he's a brahmana, but from holding the dhanus, he looks like a kshatriya. Further, Sahasa Soma, he appears as cool as the moon, but Iva Gharma Dijitihi, but he also is as hot as the sun. Sadvijahva Iva Chandana Drumaha, he appears ferocious as the snake, but he's also as soothing to the eye as Chandana Drumaha, like the sandalwood tree. So this is none other than Parashurama. So Parashurama's father is a Brahmin, that is, Jamadagni, and his mother Revati is a Kshatriya. So beautifully, Kalidasa in this shloka is telling that as a sign of his father, who is a Brahmin, he is wearing the Upavita. And as a sign of the mother, who is Kshatriya, he is holding the bow. And he appears like a Dvandva. He has both contradicting features. He looks as cool as the moon, but he is also as hot as the sun. He looks as ferocious as the snake, but he also looks as pleasing as the sandalwood tree. Beautifully, again, Kalidasa goes on to describe how he, on the orders of his father, beheaded his mother, and how he went around the world, he killed Kartavirya Arjuna and killed Kshatriyas 21 times. All that is beautifully explained. Tam pitur vada bhavena manyuna raja vamsha nidhanaya dikshitam balasunu ravalokya bhargavam swam dishamcha vishasada parthivaha. So who is this Parashurama? How is this Parashurama? He is the Parashurama who had promised dikshitam. He has taken an oath that he will kill Raja Vamsha Nidhanaya. He'll exterminate or he'll kill all the Kshatriyas. Why? Pituhu Vadabhavena. Because of the death of his father, that person who had taken the oath to kill all the Kshatriyas, seeing that type of a Bhargava, Parthiva, the king Dasharatha, Balasunuhu Swandashamcha Avalokya Vishasada. That Dasharatha is now very anxious. And he's also very dejected that, because for a Kshatriya, seeing Parashurama is actually a very bad omen, because Parakshatriya, Parashurama is the person who will kill Kshatriya. So for a Kshatriya to see Bhargava right in front of him, it's a very bad omen. So Dasharatha is very dejected that what will be the situation, what will happen to him and his young sons, Palasun, who is young sons. And finally, नाम राम इति तुल्यमात्मजे वर्तमान महिते च दारुणे हृद्यमस्य भयदायि चाभवत् रत्नजातमिव हारसर्पयोः. सो देर आर टू रामास. सो परशुराम, एक्चुअली द नेम गिवन टू हिम वाज राम. Since he wields an axe, he is called Parashurama. So there are two Ramas here. One is Bhargava Rama, one is Dasharathi Rama. So Rama Nama iti Tulyam Atmache. So the name Rama is befitting to both of them. How? Vartamana Mahitecha Darune. So one is very pleasing. So we have seen during the Namakarana of Rama, Ramateti Rama, one who pleases anyone who sees him is Rama. And one is Bhayadai, one who is creative. So one is creating happiness in your mind, whereas one is creating fear in your mind. And Kalidasa beautifully compares this to Ratna. If there is a gem, if it is residing on a head of the serpent as Nagamani, it is very dangerous. It looks very scary. But if that same jewel is in a hara, in a necklace, it is very pleasing. Similarly, the same name Rama is one instilling fear and in the other is instilling happiness in the mind. Now, Dasharatha is already scared. So what he is doing, first he wants to please Bhargava. So he tells, please bring water for Argya. So, you know, for the Pada Puja and all that, please bring Argya. But the, you know, Bhargava is not even worried about that. He has fixed his eyes, you know, his rage-filled eyes on Rama as though he's shooting arrows of fire from them. Now, he takes up his bow. So, you know, he's not worried about the satkara being done by Dasharatha. He does not care about that. He takes up his bow, he picks up his arrow and tells Rama, I have killed Kshatriyas before and I had become calm. But now, because of what you have done at Mithila, now I have again, you know, started to become angry and have again taken up my weapons. And beautifully again, Kalidasa tells it, Anyata Jagati Rama Ityayam Shabda Uccharita Eva Mamagat Vrida Mavahi Mesa Samprati Vyasta Vritti Rudayon Mukhetvai. So, till this point of time, that is till before you came, Anyada, till this point, Jagati Rama Ityayam Shabdaha Mamagata Eva Uchatata. So till this point of time, only I was called Rama. And Vidam Aham Avaha Avahati Avahati Me Samprati. But today, that name has brought me shame. Why? Tvat Udayon Mukhe. Tvai Udayon Mukhe. Now that you, because see, there are again various ways in which this incident has been depicted. So one tells that Parashurama considered breaking the Shivadhanus as, breach of respect to Shiva and all that. But here, what is happening is, Rama is becoming more famous because of his act. So breaking Shivadhanas, first of all, lifting Shivadhanas itself is a great thing. On top of that, Rama has broken the Shivadhanas. So Parashurama is telling that because of the fame that you are getting, my name is becoming less and less famous and that is creating shame. So Vrida Mavahati, that name Rama is creating shame because you are becoming famous and you are taking away the name that I had, is what Kalidasa has beautifully used the words as. And if you go into Valmiki Ramayana, there another beautiful statement is made that, see, both of us are named Rama. So there should only be one Rama who is all powerful. Either you let go of your name Rama or you fight with me. That is the only way that there will continue to be only one Rama who is famous. So that is how Valmiki beautifully describes it. And this is how Kalidasa beautifully describes it. Then he tells that, Parashurama tells it, there have been only two enemies in my life. One was Kartavirya who stole my cow, and the second is you who's trying to steal my fame. So here you have two parties. One, Parashurama is Kshatriya Kula Samharaka, and one is Dasharathi Rama who is Kshatriya Kula Deepaka. So beautifully this conversation has been brought out, and he tells that, so in order to become as prominent I was before you came, I have to subdue you. That is either by defeating you in battle, by killing you, or by you surrendering and giving up your name. And finally, when Rama, so Rama does not want to fight. He's a peace-loving person, so he does not tell anything. When Rama does not accept to fight, finally what Parashurama tells is, Tam idam ayudham jaya sangamayya sharam vikrishyatam tishthatu pradhanamevam pyaham tulya bahurataya tulya bahurasaya ajitastvaya. So at least if you don't want to fight me, then take this bow of mine. So he has Vaishnavadhanas. So he gives that Vaishnavadhanas to Rama and tells it, okay, if you don't want to fight with me, at least take this weapon of mine and Sangamayya Sharam. So string this, put the Pratyancha on this Vaishnavadhanas and mount an arrow on this. Just by doing this, Tishthatu Pradhanam, you become great and Tulya Bahu Jitastvaya. And just by doing this, I will accept my defeat and I'll accept your victory. So once this is done, Parashurama tells, if you are still not ready to even do this, so first you told you won't fight with me. Secondly, if you even won't accept my condition of stringing and putting an arrow on this Vaishnava Dhanas, then that hands that should actually be holding bows and pulling strings, let that be joined as, you know, a namaskara, that is like for with folded arms, fall on my feet, fall on my feet and beg forgiveness. But as a fitting reply to Bhargava's, that is Parashurama's words, Rama picks up that Vaishnava Dhanas, and similar to how easily Manmatha puts the string around his Pushpachapa, Rama easily puts the string on Vaishnava Dhanas. And at this, once you know Rama, that is Dasharathi Rama, puts the string easily on the Vaishnava Dhanas, Tavubhavapi parasparasthitau vardhamana parihina tejasau pashyatisma janata dinatyaye paurna parvanau shashi divakara yoriva. So now we have two Ramas and they are facing each other. And how is this situation once Rama has put the string on the Vaishnava Dhanas? Vardhamana, one person, that is Dasharathi's Rama, his teja vardhamana, his fame is increasing. But the other Rama, that is Parashurama, parihina teja, his fame is being deteriorated. So one fame is increasing while the other fame is decreasing. And how is this being compared? Similar to how at the end of the day, in the evening, the glow of the sun goes on reducing and the glow of the moon starts increasing. Similarly, that fame of Parashurama has started to decrease and the fame of Rama has started to increase. So now Rama places the arrow on the Vaishnava Dhanas that he has strung. And it is custom. We know that Rama, once he puts the arrow on his bow, he'll never take it back. So now he asks Parashurama, Na prahartum alamaspi nirdayam vipra itya bhibhatya pitvaya shamsakim gati manena patrina hanmi lokamutate makharjitam. So he asks, so what shall I destroy with this arrow of mine? So there are two things that I can think of. First thing is gatim. So Parashurama is told to have the, he has a gati. So gati is nothing but the capability to travel. So, and it is also, it's a side story that Parashurama had given this bhumi as dana, and hence he is not allowed to sleep on earth. So he never sleeps and he goes from one loka to the other loka to sleep. So that is the power that he has been given. So gati is that power of movement. So Rama is asking, anena patatrina, by this arrow, kim shamsa kim hanmi, what shall I destroy? Gatim, shall I destroy your ability to move? Or uta makharjitam lokam. So Parashurama, being a Brahmin, has also performed a lot of makha, that is yajnas. And when you perform several yajnas, you attain higher worlds. So because of his yajnas, Parashurama has attained higher worlds. So Rama is asking, shall I destroy your ability of movement, or shall I destroy that higher worlds that you have attained by doing yajnas? Parashurama tells that, okay, so it was actually, so Parashurama then agrees. So it is because of those higher worlds that I was very egoistic and very, arrogant. So please destroy that, makhajita loka, those higher worlds, because then I will be, I won't have this ego. And also this gati is important to me because I have to go from pilgrim place to pilgrim place and gati is more important to me. So please go ahead and destroy those, higher worlds and please leave this ability to move my gati with me. And having said that, Rama shot a heaven which blocked the path. So he shot an arrow to the east and it blocked the path to heaven. So now Parashurama can no longer go to heaven until he performs some more yagas. So in this way, Rama touches, of course, after all this is done, still Dasharathi Rama goes and touches Parashurama's feet and asks forgiveness. And Bhargava is very pleased and he tells, all this had to happen, and he blesses him and goes away. And now Dasharatha is pleased. So till now, Balasunu, even in the previous loka, Dasharatha was fearing that his sons were still young because he had not seen the parakrama of Rama and Lakshmana. But having seen how Rama dealt with Parashurama, Dasharatha is very pleased. So with this, the 11th sarga ends. 12th sarga, now Dasharatha has reached a very old age. And at this point of time, Tam karna moola magatya Rameshri nyasyatamiti kaikeyi shankaye vaha patat palitat chadmana jara. So Rama, Dasharatha is becoming old. So beautifully, you should understand how much Kalidasa has concentrated to read these shlokas. Because, so when you become old, the first sign is you get white hair. And even in that white hair, where does the first white hair grow? It also always grows in the side locks. That is very close to this ear. That is where the first white hairs grow. So having observed that so keenly, Kalidasa uses that in a beautiful way. He tells that Chadma, so Chadma Vesha is nothing but in disguise. So Jara, the old age, in the disguise of the white hair, growing near his ear, that white hair went and karnamoolam agatya, having come. So of course, he has used that beautifully because he's saying that that white hair that is growing near his ear has come and whispered something into the ear of Dasharatha. So karnamoolam agatya aha. What did it tell? It's whispering that Rame Shrihi Nyasyatam. Please give this. So it is indirectly telling that you're already old. So please give this Shrihi, this Rajalakshmi, that is this Ayodhya and the kingdom, Rame. So give it to Rama. Iti aha. But why is it whispering? Kaikeyi Shankaya. Fearing or doubting Kaikeyi. So here, Kalidasa, again, as I've told, he has not gone into the depth of this Varayachana, etc. So there are two reasons. One is probably because Kaikeyi might have already indicated that she wants Bharata to be the king. So that Shanka. So this old age is telling that because of the doubt that he has about Kaikeyi, it is whispering. Or secondly, when Dasharatha married Kaikeyi, he would have promised his father that, her father, that he will make his son as the king. So in a way that, of course, since that should be the case, but this Jara, this old age is telling that, please don't go by that, secretly or, you know, silently make Rama the king. So in that way, that old age in the disguise of that white hair comes and whispers in the ear of Dasharatha that, please give the kingdom to Rama. Now, you know, then finally Dasharatha is planning to make the, you know, Rama the king of Ayodhya. But at this time, Kaikeyi comes and asks the two varas. Tayosh chaturdashaikena ramam pravrajayat samaha dvitiyena sutaichhat sutasyaichhat vaidhavyaika phalam shriyam. So with one vara, she asks for 14 years of exile of Rama. And in the second, she asks sutasya shriyam, the kingdom to the, you know, his son, her son, Bharata. But Kalidasa beautifully tells that finally, because of the two varas, one was sending Rama to the forest, and the second was by asking the kingdom to Bharata, what is the actual boon that she got? Vaidhavyam. So as the phalaswarup or the result of both these varas, finally, you know, Kaikeyi was bestowed with widowhood. She attained Vaidhavya because of these two varas. Now, Pitradattam Rudan Ramaha Prangmahim Pratyapadyata Paschalvanayaka Cheti Tadagnyam Mudito Grahit. So initially, when Dasharatha told, oh Rama, please take up this kingdom and become the king, when that, you know, when Dasharatha told that Rudan Ramaha, so you know, Rama was very sad. He was, you know, sad that he's doing it in such a secretive way. So Bharata and Shatrughna are in their maternal and uncle's place, and when they are away, Dasharatha wants to silently make Rama the king. So he's very sad and Rudan, he's accepted with sadness. But Paschat Vanaya Gacheti, and later he was ordered to go to the forest, Muditaha Agrahit, he received it very happily. And Rama and Lakshmana, along with Sita, they enter into the Dandakaranya forest. Now Dasharatha, he remembers that, okay, he again remembers all the Shravana Kumara incident and all that. And he feels that the body is very, you know, deteriorated because of the grief. So he feels that it is the best thing to do is leave this body and go. So that is how Dasharatha's soul finally leaves the body and he expires. Now, the kingdom is now without princes. So, if there is a, you know, the princes are not away, Bharata Shatrughna are away, Rama Lakshmana are away, Dasharatha has died. In this case, there could be several enemies that could attack. So, ministers having carefully thought, they immediately bring Bharata and they try to make him the king. But when Bharata comes to know about the father's death and also the boons of his mother, he immediately does not even look at Kaikeyi and goes away. And Pratima Nataka is actually a very beautiful Nataka written by Bhasa Mahakavi. And there, this exact situation, in this exact situation, Bharata tells a beautiful statement. So when, you know, he's going away from Ayodhya, the ministers tell, and even his mother still, please stay and protect Ayodhya. But at that point, Bharata tells it, Na Ayodhya tam vina Ayodhya sa Ayodhya yatra Raghavaha. That Ayodhya is not an Ayodhya where Raghava is not there. And that place itself is Ayodhya, where Raghava himself is present. So this place is no longer Ayodhya. And wherever Raghava, that is Rama, is residing, that place itself is Ayodhya. So now, finally, Bharata goes, he comes to know that, you know, Rama, Lakshmana, Sita are living in Chitrakuta. So he goes there and he informs about the death of his father and asks Rama to come back and take the kingdom. But again, Rama does not accept. And when Rama does not accept, Bharata takes Rama's Paduka and takes it and places it in the kingdom, telling that in the absence of Rama, this will be the ruling king. And he himself stayed outside the city in a place called Nandigrama. He never entered the capital. He took up ascetic life. So similar to how Rama was living in Vanavasa, wearing bark dress, matted hair and all that, even Bharata lived a similar life living outside. So Kalidasa beautifully tells it is not because he has done a mistake. He is trying to do prayaschitta for the sin committed by his mother. So now, Rama has lived in the forest, and you know, what, as you know, Kalidasa says it, what Ikshvaku rulers used to do when they were old, Rama is now doing that when he is young. So usually Ikshvaku people, they take Vanaprastha once they are old and you know, their kingdom is safe in their son's hands, but Rama is forced to do that in his youth. And there is one important incident that Kalidasa takes. So Rama is sleeping on the, you know, in the shade of a tree on Sita's lap. At that time, Indra's son Jayanta, he takes the form of a crow and he scratches the skin of Sita. And hearing Sita cry, Rama is very angry and he throws a blade of grass. It's called Ishikastra. So that grass itself became a weapon, Astra. And he threw that at Jayanta, and it followed Jayanta all around the world. Jayanta went to Brahmaloka, he went to, you know, Kailas, everywhere, asking him to be protected, but no one could protect him from that Ishikastra. And finally, when no one could free him from that Astra, he finally came back to Rama and surrendered. And as a result, he did not lose his life, but it is told that Jayanta lost one of his eyes. So in this way, Jayanta's incident also is brought about. And also, there is a very beautiful shloka called Sri Rama Krishna Yugala Stuti. So there, this exact shloka is told, but in a very beautiful way. So Rama Krishna Yugala Stuti, you should understand this. It's a shloka wherein, based on how you split the sandhis and do the samasas, the same shloka will describe both Rama as well as Krishna. Tratah kakodaro yena drobdhapi karunatmana putanama aranakhyatah samestu sharanam viprabhu. So this is a shlesha alankara wherein, based on how you decide, you know, divide this sandhis. So first way, if you want to take it in the perspective of Rama, so that karunatmana, so that you know, kind-hearted, you know, soul, that kind-hearted person who kakaha drobdhapi yena trataha. So that Rama who protected that Kakasura sandhi, but Jayanta again. So that Rama who protected Kakasura, who troubled him. So even though Kakasura troubled Rama, finally Rama protected that person. And also one Putanama Ranakhyataha, that Rama was also famous for fighting in a very just way. He did, never used treachery, he never used deceit. That Rama who fought in a very chivalrous way, let that Rama's grace be on me. This is Rama Stuti. Krishna Stuti is Kakodara. So Kakodara means snake. So that Karunatmana, that kind soul, kind-hearted Krishna, who even though being troubled by Kalinga Sarpa, protected him later from Garuda. So that type of Kalinga Sarpa, that type of Krishna, who Putana Marana Khyataha, who is famous for killing Putana, let his blessings be on me. So this is Ramakrishna Yugala Stuti. Very beautifully this is mentioned. Now Rama, he has stayed in Chitrakuta for some time, but he feels that Bharata might keep coming back and, you know, persuading Rama to come back to the kingdom. So he decides that we should not stay here. So they decide to leave Chitrakuta and they start traveling south. Now Sita, you know, in the beginning itself, Sita is given some fragrant pastes by Anusuya. And the beauty of this, or the, you know, greatness of this paste given by Anusuya is, if it is applied, then there is no effect of fatigue, wind, sun, fire, anything. So there won't be any effect on Sita. So that is how this, that is how powerful this paste given by Anusuya is. Then, after all this is done, as they travel, keep traveling south, a demon called Viradha takes away, you know, or kidnaps Sita, but Rama and Lakshmana kill him and free Sita. That's a small incident. Panchavatyam tato Ramaha Shasanat Kumbhajanmanaha Anapodhasthitastavsthav Vindyadri Prakritaviva Kumbhajanma. So Kumbhayoni is a thing, but Agastya. So Agastya, on the orders of Agastya, Rama, Lakshmana, Sita, they decide to stay at Panchavati. And how did they agree? Similar to how Vindhyaparvatas agreed to the orders of Agastya, Rama, Lakshmana, Sita also agreed to the orders of Agastya. So that's a story that this Vindhyaparvata had the power to keep on growing. And so the people crossing from north, so Vindhyas actually is in the middle of North and South India. So it's dividing India into North and South India. So people traveling from North to South could not keep on climbing. So every time they came, Vindhya Parvata would have grown. So they ask Agastya Muni to help. So Agastya, he is a very short person. So he tells that when he's crossing, so Vindhya Parvata bends down and salutes. So he tells that, okay, so I'm a very old sage. So I'm going to the South for some work. So I'll be coming back. So please don't grow till then because it'll be difficult. So Vindhya Parvata accepts, but Agastya, it is told that he went to the south and did not come back. So Vindhya Parvata did not grow. So similar to how those Vindhya Parvatas agreed to the orders of Agastya, even Rama Lakshmana agreed and stayed at Panchavati. Then Shurpanaka, the younger sister of Ravana, she comes, she sees Rama and she approaches him and, you know, with a desire to marry. So in the presence of Sita itself, so even when Sita is present right in front of her, she goes and, you know, tells the time, you know, the daughter and the sister of Ravana and Ravana as the king of Lanka. So she starts telling, boasting about her clan. Finally, Rama tells, Kalatravanaham Bale Kaniyamsam Bhajaswami. Kalatravanaham. So I am, I have come with my wife and I have taken a vow that I will marry only one person. So Kaniyamsam Bhajaswa. So Kaniyamsam is the younger one. So please go and ask or request my younger brother Lakshmana. So Lakshmana, you know, having, when Shurpanaka approached Lakshmana, Lakshmana will tell that, see, you had come to marry my brother and he's better than me in every aspect. So you should not, you know, come and ask me. You should go and ask again Rama. So again, she goes to Rama. Rama again tells no. She again comes back to Lakshmana. Lakshmana again tells no. So in this way, she was as though a river that has been, you know, hitting from bank to bank. In that way, Shurpanaka goes to and fro between Rama and Lakshmana. Seeing this, she's seeing how, you know, Shurpanaka was being rejected by both Rama and Lakshmana, Sita starts. Sita laughs. Sita actually smiles. And at that point, Shurpanaka, in a very angry way, she is, till now, she's a very beautiful woman. But now she becomes angry and she tells, Thalamasyopahasasya sadyav prapsasi pashyamam mrigyah paribhavo vyagriyam ityavehi tvayakartam. So you will surely bear the result of this disgrace. So you smiled at me. So you will surely bear the result of this. And I will make sure that you repent for this. And she takes her actual form. So she takes her demoness form. And once this is done, Sita goes and tries to hide behind her husband. But she tries to come and, you know, kill or, you know, hurt Sita. But Shurpanaka, Lakshmana immediately comes. He chops off the, you know, ear and nose of Shurpanaka. And Kalidasa tells that already Shurpanaka's demonic form was very bad to see. And after Lakshmana cut off the ear and nose, it became even more difficult. Then she, you know, starts crying and she goes to Janasthana where her cousins, that is Khara and Dushana, are present. And she tells the story of what has happened. So Khara and Dushana are very angry and they come along with their army to Rama. And Rama first puts Sita in the, you know, protection of Lakshmana, and he comes and he single-handedly eliminates all the demons. And Shurpanaka was the only one alive. So she runs to Ravana and tells what is the news. Rakshasa mrigarupena vanchayitvasa raghavau jahara sitam pakshindra prayasa kshanavighnitaha. And finally, Rama, with the help of Rakshasa mrigarupena, so with the help of the Rakshasa who had come in the form of a deer, that is Nithimat Maricha, vanchayitvasa raghavaha, that Ravana, having deceived or having, you know, made them go in the wrong way, the Raghavau, that is Rama as well as Lakshmana, having deceived Rama and Lakshmana, Jahara Sita, he kidnapped, that Ravana kidnapped Sita. But Pakshendra Prayasa Kshana Vignitaha, but he was stopped, or his progress was stopped for a Kshana, for a moment, because of Pakshendra Prayasa, because of the efforts of Jatayu, Pakshendra, his effort of, you know, capturing Sita was stopped for a very small time. But immediately he had cut off the wings of Jatayu and he had gone further. Then finally, when, you know, they come, Rama and Lakshmana come in search of Sita, Jatayu is in his last breaths of his life and he informed Rama about Ravana and having fulfilled. So Jatayu is a very close friend of Dasharatha. So he feels that he has fulfilled the, you know, debt of friendship. So he has fulfilled his friendship in a very good way. He leaves his body and he slept eternally. And Rama and Lakshmana, they perform the final rites of Jatayu. And when they do this, they actually feel that they are experiencing their father did the second time. So first time when Bharata told itself, they are sad about their father's death. But when they actually perform the Antya Samskara of Jatayu, they get a feeling of having seen their father die the second time. So that is how close Jatayu was to Dasharatha. So now they go further and, you know, they kill a demon named Kabandha. And that Kabandha would have been cursed. And on being relieved from the curse, they, you know, he tells that you should go and meet Sugriva and he'll help you. So once they go there and they, of course, meet Hanuman, and having met Sugriva, Rama helps him kill Vali and he puts Sugriva on the throne. Once that is done, Sugriva sends all the monkeys in search of Sita. And finally, Pravritta Vupalabdhayam Tasya Sampati Darshanat Maruti Sagaram Tirnaha Samsaram Iva Nirmamaha. So there's a very beautiful or a very famous quote. Maruti Sagaram Tirna Samsaram Iva Nirmama. So, as different batches of monkeys went to different directions, Hanuman has come to the south. And there, Sampati Darshanath, having seen Sampati, the younger brother of Jatayu, and having been informed of Sita's present state, that is, she is in Lanka, Maruti Sagaram Tirna, Maruti crossed the Samudra. And how was it? Nirmama Samsaram Iva Tirna. So, Nirmama, a person who does not have any desire or any attachments to this worldly life, how he crosses samsara in a very easy way. How Nirmama, or a person who is Nirmama, how he easily crosses this ocean called samsara in a very similar way. Hanuman easily crossed this ocean called samudra. So now he crosses, and once he reaches there, he sees Sita sitting in the middle of all the demonesses, and he finally gives the ring given by Anguliyaka, given by Rama, and she recognizes him. Finally, Nirvapya Priya Sandeshaihi Sita Moksha Vadodhataha Sadadaha Purim Lankam Kshanasodhari Nigraha. So having given the message of Rama to her beloved, to his beloved Sita, Sadadaha Purim, he destroyed or he burned the Lankapuri. Kshana Sodhari Nigraha, but he was, even though he was Kshana for a very small or for a moment, he was captured by Brahmastra. Even then, after that, small moment, he finally burned the entire Lanka. And after having successfully, after that, the successful monkey Hanuman, he returned, he gave the, Sita Chudamani to Rama, and then preparations of war are made. So as you can see, the story goes in a very fast pace. So he's covering so much of story in such a small time. That is the greatness of Kalidasa. So once preparations are being done, Vibhishana comes and approaches Rama. At this point of time, Tasmai Nishacharishwaryam Pratishishrava Raghavaha Kale Khalu Samalabdhaha Phalam Badhananti Nitayaha. So once Vibhishana comes and surrenders to Rama, what Rama first does is Pratishishrava, he promised Vibhishana about Lanka. He told that, I will surely make you the king of Lanka. And beautifully Kalidasa tells that, Kale khalu samalabdhaha phalam badhinanti nitayaha. Decisions that are taken at the right time will surely bear fruits. So he did not think twice. He told, okay, you're supporting me, I'm very happy. So I'll promise that I will give you Lanka, that I'll make you the Lankadhipati. So decisions made at the right time. Kale khalu samalabdhaha phalam badhinanti nitayaha. Immediately, or they bear fruits surely. So finally, bridge is built across the ocean along with the monkeys, and a fierce battle emerges between the Rakshasas and the monkeys. But how was this battle? Kalidasa beautifully tells that. So this is a very peculiar battle because trees that are thrown. So if a tree is thrown, it will break iron clubs. Stones that are thrown will break gadas. Nails cause more pain than swords. So indirectly he's telling that Asuras had gadas, they had clubs, they had swords, they had arrows. But that did not cause so much of trouble or so much of effect, rather than the trees that were being thrown by the Kapisayana, or the stones that are being thrown, or even the nails. So monkeys have nails. So they inflicted more damage than the weapons of the Asuras. So such a type of unique battle this is. So in the meantime, when the war preparations are still going on, what Ravana does is he gets a fake head of Rama and shows it to Sita. Sita, seeing Rama's head, she immediately faints. So it's like just the head of Rama is brought, telling that I have cut the head of Rama and brought it. So seeing that, Sita faints, but Trichata finally tells that no, it is just a Maya. It is just magic that is being done by these Asuras. So don't worry. Then fine, again, the battle is not very detailed. It just goes on continuing, telling that then Rama and Lakshmana, they fall unconscious because of Nagastra, and finally Garuda comes and saves them. Then Tato bibheda paulastyaha shaktya vakshasi lakshmanam ramastvanahito pyasita vidirna hridayaha shucha. Then Ravana shot the shakti astra at Lakshmana. Again, as I told you, the name of the astras can change between Valmiki Ramayana and what we are reading in Raghuvamsha, but the understanding is the same. So Ravana is told to have shot the shakti astra at Lakshmana, and even though that astra of Ravana did not hit Rama, because Lakshmana was hurt, even Rama was as hurt as Lakshmana himself. So thereupon, Hanuman goes and gets a Sanjeevini, a herb, and Lakshmana is revived, and they resume fighting. Then finally, Lakshmana kills Meghanad, and then Sugriva cuts the nose of Kumbhakarna, Kalidasa beautifully tells that when Sugriva cuts the nose of Kumbhakarna, Kumbhakarna now looks very similar to Shurpanakha. So after that, finally, Rama's arrow, telling that, beautifully, Kalidasa tells it. So Kumbhakarna is to be woken up at a specific time, and Ravana went and woke him up early. So as though giving an indication that arrow shot by Rama went and gave the message that, oh Kumbhakarna, I know you are, you know, you like sleeping a lot, so that Ravana made you get up early, so please go and have a Chiranidra, go and sleep forever. In that way, those arrows of Rama went and killed Kumbhakarna. Finally, there is no one left and there is only Ravana that is remaining. Nirjayavatha paulasyah punaryuddhaya mandirat aravanam aramam va jagadadyeti nischitah. Then that Ravana, who was the only person who was standing on the Rakshasa side, he came for the next day of battle. And nischitya, he came up with a decision. What was the decision? Jagat adya, today the world should become aravanam va aramam. Today the world should become aravana, that is without Ravana, or arama, or without Rama. So one of these two should happen today. Having hence decided, Ravana came to the battle with Rama. Now, Ravana is sitting on a chariot, whereas Rama is on foot. Seeing this, Indra sends his charioteer, along with the chariot. Now, Rama boards that chariot. He puts on the armor of Indra, and then the battle of Ravana and Rama begins. And beautifully, you know, Kalidasa tells it, Anyonya darshana prapti vikramavasaram chirat Rama Ravana yor yuddham charitartham iva bhavat. So this type of battle has been long awaited. There has never been such a beautiful or such an amazing battle, interesting battle for a very long time. Chirat. Hence, everyone is seeing. So everyone, you know, gods are seeing Rama fight and the demons are seeing Ravana fight. And they have never seen such a ferocious battle. So all of them are witness to this battle. And Rama Ravana yor yuddham, the battle between Rama and Ravana, charitartham iva abhavat, it became history. That is, it became a historic battle. This battle between Rama and Ravana is one of the most historic battles ever fought in history. And if you read Valmiki's Ramayana, Valmiki tells it, Rama Ravana yor yuddham, Rama Ravana yor iva. So the battle between Rama and Ravana is like Rama and Ravana's battle itself. So there is no other comparison. Hence, even Kalidasa, who is told Upama Kavi, who is very good at giving similes, when Valmiki himself had no similes to compare this battle, he also did not use any simile and he used Charitartham Iva Abhavat. It became historic. So finally, Rama shot, you know, the arrow at Ravana, and Ravana shot the arrows at Rama, and they collide each other, and you know, they create a huge thundering sound. And it's also told that when one time Rama is winning, so people on his side are cheering. One time Ravana is winning, so people on his side are cheering. So they both are confused who will win the battle. Such a thrilling battle this was. And also, both the sides, so Devatas on Rama's side and Rakshasas on Ravana's side, they both are showering flowers respecting the heroes. But those flowers never even reach Rama and Ravana because the arrows and the weapons that are thrown by each other, they are so crowded that the flowers are, you know, spread out outside because of this insane number of weapons that are being thrown at each other. Now, then finally, Rama shoots the Brahmastra within a blink of the eye. That Brahmastra goes and removes all the heads of Ravana at once, and in a very swift way, Ravana falls to the earth. At this point of time, all the gods, they shower flowers on Rama, and finally, this is the Rama. So the flower, the on whose head these gods have showered flowers, soon he will be the one who will be coronated. So finally, Rama, having, you know, removed the string. So first thing that any archer does is, when he goes for battle, puts a string. And once the battle is ended, he removes the string. So Kalidasa again particularly mentions that having won over Ravana, he unstrung his bow, indirectly telling that the war was over. And Matali went back with this chariot. And then in just one shloka, you know, Kalidasa says that Rama then accepted Sita, who was purified by the sacred fire. He made Vibhishana the king and departed with Sugriva, Lakshmana and the others to Ayodhya on the Pushpaka Vimana. So with this, the next sarga, that is the 12th sarga, has ended. So as you can see, the 12th sarga itself started with the the Vanavasa of Rama and ended with the death of Ravana and the coming back of Rama, Sita, Lakshmana to Ayodhya. So I'll just conclude with 13th sarga, because 13th sarga is a very short sarga. So 13th sarga is the description. So now they're flying in Pushpaka Vimana and they're coming from Lanka to Ayodhya. So on the way, as they're flying above, they can see so many things below, and the Prakriti Saundarya is what is the main description or the main theme of 13th sarga. So now, as you know, they have been traveling on ground. So when you travel on ground, you see only some things. But when you're traveling by air, you see a lot more things. So the description is very beautiful. For example, you know, as they go from Lanka towards India, as they cross the ocean, Rama shows, oh, Sita, so see, this is the bridge that I built to come and get you. And see, this bridge is dividing the entire ocean into two parts. And then once they reach, you know, the oceans, and Rama tells, so these oceans were actually built by my ancestors, Sagarasans. So when they were going to Patralaloka to search for Kapila Muni, that time, whatever they built, as you know, whatever they dug became the Samudras. And these are the mountains that have come and, you know, sat here after their wings have been cut off. And again, he tells he points out, telling that the Janasthana. So Janasthana was the place where Karadushana had lived. Now, you know, Rama had killed all of them, and that place had become devoid, or there were no asuras at all. So he shows Janasthana and says, oh, Sita, do you remember this is Janasthana where we killed Khara and Dushana? And look, because there are no more demons, all the sages have started to come and build their ashramas and kutiras, and they're starting to do yajnas here. And then he tells this, and he shows one more place, and he tells, okay, see, Sita, this is the place where when I was searching for you, I found one of your anklets. And then he tells, again, Prakriti Sandarya is the main theme. He tells, when I was searching for you and I asked the trees for directions of finding you, this is the place where a creeper, it turned its leaves pointing to the direction where you went. And in this area, there were some deers. Because of the sorrow that after you were abducted by Ravana, these deers also were so sad that they stopped eating. And when I asked them for directions, they, without any talking or without any sound, pointed to our direction. And then he points to a mountain called Malyavata. So he tells that this is the mountain where I sat and cried, thinking of you, and when you were abducted. And then he again when they start going towards Ayodhya, they see the Pampa Lake, and they see the Godavari River. Then they reach Panchavati, and again Panchavati is where they had spent so much of time, so they recognize the place very well. And again he shows that, so this is a very important samudra called Panchapsara. And then again he shows this is the place where Agastya is performing the Yaga. Then this is the place where Ganga and Yamuna join together to form the Sangama. And then they reach the place which is the city of Guha. So Guha is the person who would have helped them cross the Ganga. So he tells, so this, do you remember Guha? So this is the place where he lives. And finally, they reach Sarayu. So once they reach Sarayu, it means that they're very close to Ayodhya. Having seen Sarayu, they reach Ayodhya. Bharata comes along with his Kula Guru, Vasishta, and all the ministers. And then, of course, even before all these people come in Pushpaka Vimana, Hanuman has gone before and informed Bharata of Rama's victory over Ramana and his return. So Bharata as well as Vasishta and the ministers, they have come. Rama salutes to Vasishta and he embraces Bharata with tears of joy. Then Rama introduces Sugriva, Angada, all those people, and of course Vibhishana, who is the king. Then Lakshmana first bows to Bharata, but Bharata is so sad of this separation that he goes and hugs and embraces Bharata. Then finally what happens is, Ramagnaya Harichamu Patihi Tadanim Kritva Manushya Vapuhu Aruruhu Gajendran. So now, the what is the army of Rama? They're monkeys, bears, and all these animals. But because if such an army enters into Ayodhya, people will get scared. Rama tells it, okay, all of you, please assume the forms of human beings. So Rama Gnaya, by the orders of Rama, Harichamu, the army of Rama, Tadanim Manushya, Manushyatvam Kritva, having attained the forms, or having disguised in the forms of human beings or human forms, Aru Ruhu Gajendran, they sat on elephants. So they came like kings. So they didn't come as kapis or bears. They came as kings who were sitting on elephants. So in this way, they come to the kingdom of Ayodhya. And in the meantime, Rama has again, he's still in the Pushpaka Vimana with Sita and Lakshmana. Bharata comes, he salutes Sita, and Sita blesses him. And then they go in the Pushpaka Vimana. So in the Pushpaka Vimana, only Rama, Bharata, Lakshmana, and Sita, these are the people who are the Pushpaka Vimana, and they go to the outskirts of Ayodhya. So they can't enter Ayodhya because first he has to be coronated as a king, and they have to do so many yagas for the completion of his vanavasa and all the troubles that he has gone through. After all that, so they stop at the camps just outside Ayodhya, and there the sarga number 13, Trayodasha Sarga, ends. So we'll conclude today's class with this 13th sarga, and the next class we'll surely complete Raghuvamsha, because after this the story goes quite fast. So with that, we'll conclude today's class. So any doubts you can ask. So we'll conclude today's class.
the way you described was such that it was just a picture going on.
Asti guru mama pahi guru. Sorry, I didn't get you.
No, the way you were narrating the story was something. It was a scene going on just like that. It was very nice.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. So with that, we'll conclude today's class. And hopefully, yeah, probably not just hopefully. I want to complete this Raghuvamsha in the next class. So of course, it will be 5 classes of Raghuvamsha. But yeah, the story is quite interesting. So let us hope that the next class will conclude Raghuvamsha. Okay.
Ram Ram Ram.
Ram Ram Ram.